Hi students, in this video we are going to discuss about significance of Newton's law. Newton's laws are vector laws. The equation F vector that is equal to M A vector is a vector equation, and essentially it is equivalent to three scalar equations. Here I have taken the Cartesian coordinate system. Imagine an object is accelerating three-dimensionally, then you can understand some external force is acting on the object. That's why it is accelerator. For our convenience, let us take here. Three-dimensionally, you have to imagine object is moving three-dimensionally. So on that object, F vector is acting. Mass of the object is M. The acceleration of the object is given by the letter A vector. Since force and the acceleration are the vector quantities that can be divided along the three axes. But what about the M? Mass of the object is a constant value. Even force is applied on the object, there is no change in the mass. So mass is a scalar quantity, we can't divide. But these vector quantities can be divided along the axis. So along the X axis, we have the component Fx. Along the Y axis, we have the component Fy. Along the Z axis, Fz. So this F vector can be written like this. So here I have written the components of this F vector. We know I cap, J cap, K cap are the orthogonal unit vectors which are in the X axis, Y axis and the Z axis respectively. So likewise, A vector is at the right side, that can be split along the three axes. So along the X axis, its acceleration is Ax. Along the y-axis, this object has the acceleration Ay. The component of acceleration along the z-axis can be taken as Az. So how can we write M Ax? It is a magnitude only. Mass and Ax is the component in the x-axis, that is a numerical value. How can you convert that into vector quantity? For that only you have to multiply with unit vector plus M A Y J cap plus M A Z K cap. Here M is a common thing that can be taken outside. By comparing both the sides, we can write three scalar equations. We can compare the coefficient of I cap, then and you can write F X that is equal to M A X. Likewise J component F Y that is equal to M A Y, and the last component F Z that is equal to M A Z. In all the three equations, M is a constant value. So imagine that M is removed from this equation. How can you write F X directly proportional to A X, F Y directly proportional to A Y, F Z directly proportional to A Z? That means acceleration along the X direction depends only on the component of force acting along the X axis. Likewise, acceleration along the Y axis depends on the component of force acting along the Y axis. So this force cannot alter the acceleration along the X axis. Let us take this object. The acceleration experienced by the object at the time t depends only on the force which acts on the object at that instant of time. So the acceleration does not depend on the force which acted on the body before the time t. So Newton's second law can be written like this. So acceleration at the given time is depends on the force acting on the object at the instant of time only. So that acceleration is not depends on the force which acts at the beginning. Let us take one example. When a spin bowler or a fast bowler throws a ball to the batsman, once the ball leaves the hand of the bowler, it will experience only gravitational force and air frictional force. The acceleration of the ball independent of how the ball was bowled. Third case, in general, the direction of the force may be different from the direction of the motion. In some cases, the object may move in the same direction as the direction of the force. So let us take this object. I am going to apply force in this direction. that object is also move in a same direction. But in majority cases, object will move in a different direction from the direction of the force. That only we are going to discuss. Let us take the case 1. Force and motion in a same direction. Look at this picture. When an apple falls towards the earth, the direction of motion of the apple and that of force are in the same downward direction. What force is acting on the apple? Gravitational force. Gravitational force acting downwards. In the same direction, apple also moving. So both are in a same direction. Let us take the case 2. Force and motion not in the same direction. For example, let us take this example. Moon experiences a force towards the earth, but it actually moves in an elliptical orbit. In the case, the direction of the force is different from the direction of the motion. So we have taken earth, your moon. Moon is attracted by the earth, but moon is not moving towards the earth in the direction of force. Actually, it is moving in an elliptical path. Here, the direction of the motion of the object, the direction of force is not in the same direction. This is a case 2. Let us take the case 3. Force and motion in opposite direction. Look at the picture. If an object is thrown vertically upwards, the direction of motion is upwards. But what force is acting continuously on the object? Gravitational force. The gravitational force is acting downwards. So here, direction of force and direction of motion are in an opposite direction. Fourth case is the object is moving with zero net force. For this, let us take the raindrop. When a raindrop gets detached from the cloud, it experiences both downward gravitational force and the upward air drag force. So here we have to take cloud. One raindrop is detached from the cloud. We know that already downward gravitational force acting on the object. An air drag, air layer is there, you know, that is going to apply the upward force. Here gravitational force is maximum and air drag force is minimum. As the raindrop descends towards the earth, the upward air drag force increases after a certain time. The upward air drag force cancels the downward gravity. After some time, same raindrop comes down. Here gravitational force as it is, but air drag force is increases. When it is near to the surface of the earth, gravitational force and the force given by the air drag, force given by the air drag, both are equal in magnitude. Here you can compare the length. Here they both has the same length, so they both can cancel. So here net force is zero, but the raindrop moves. So in this case, raindrops moves at constant velocity till it touches the surface of the earth. Usually, the object which is moving downwards is accelerated due to gravity. But in this case, it is moving with the constant velocity. There will be no acceleration because gravitational force is cancelled by force given by the air drag. So it is an example for motion of the object with zero net force. If multiple forces acts on the same body, then the total force is equivalent to vectorial sum of the individual forces. So net force is equal to addition of individual forces acting on the object. It can be written like this also. Net force is equal to m a vector. In this case, the direction of acceleration is in the direction of net force. To understand this, they have given the example. In this rope, F1 is acting. In this rope, F2 is acting. Remember, both the forces are in a different direction. Where will be the net force? For that, we have to take the forces separately. So, F1 is acting upwards. This component can be taken separately. It can be done here. So this one I have done here. Then what about the net force? We have learned in a triangulation law of addition of vectors. So these are the two sides of a triangle. Then the resultant force will be in the third side. So it acts along this direction. Here only we can get the net force. So direction of net force acting along this direction. That's why arrow is moving forward. You know that already acceleration is the rate of change of velocity with respect to time. Here d by dt instead of v. What is velocity? Rate of change of displacement with respect to time. So instead of velocity vector, I can write dr by dt. So this expression can be written as d square r by dt square. So we can say the acceleration is the second derivative of the position vector r. So Newton's second law can also be written in the following form. F vector is equal to m. Now only we have seen instead of a vector we can write this form. So d square r by dt square. From this expression we can infer that Newton's second law is basically a second order ordinary differential equation, and whenever the second order derivative of the position vector is not equal to zero, there must be a force acting on the object. Imagine if the second derivative of the position vector, that is only known as acceleration, the acceleration is equal to zero, means there will be no force. So that's why we have told if the second derivative of the position vector is not equal to zero, there will be some force on the object. No force acting on the object, the Newton's second law, F vector that is equal to ma vector that is equal to zero. So a vector can be written as dv by dt. Rate of change of velocity with respect to time, that is equal to zero. Here dv by dt that is equal to zero. So when you can get the zero after the differentiation of your quantity, that quantity should be a constant value. For this condition, v vector is a constant value. So we can say, suppose object is moving with the constant velocity, that means there will be no acceleration, means force will be equal to zero, net force will be equal to zero. Recall the raindrop example. It is essentially Newton's first law. It implies that second law is consist with first law. The first law is it. There is no force acting on the object. That object will move with the constant velocity. So here, first law is consist with the second law. Last case, Newton's second law is cause and effect relation. Force is the cause and acceleration is the effect. Conveniently, effect should be written in the left and cause should be on the right side. So better we can write like this. MA vector that is equal to F vector, or rate of change of momentum with respect to time, that is equal to force vector.